As I mentioned earlier, we've already read the text, but let me just simply read, I think, verse 4 of Psalm 43, where the psalmist, talking about, again, the difficulties he's going through and that the Lord might have mercy upon him and bring him back to his dwelling places, then he says, "Then I will go to the altar of God, to God, my exceeding joy, and upon the lyre I shall praise you, O God, my God." Again, the Lord has made us to glorify him, and he has made us to enjoy him, and we should find this joy in the Lord. Now again, this morning, just briefly I want to mention, we saw this morning that God made us to glorify him. It's really the reason why God does all that he does, why he made everything that he made, why he is working out the particular plan that he is working out in this world, and especially why he has done everything that he has in his work of salvation to bring lost men and women to his Son, the Lord Jesus Christ. The reason why he does all of these things is that we might glorify him, that we might see his glory, that we might speak of his glory as we meet together to praise him, that we might reflect his glory in our lives as we become more like our Lord Jesus Christ, and that we might lead others to give him glory by bringing them the message of the gospel. Now this evening I want us to consider the other reason why the Lord made us, and that is that we might enjoy him. I know that sometimes we might be tempted to think that the Christian life, particularly when we read about those who lived it in the Bible, in the pages of inspired scripture, and in the pages of church history, we might be tempted to think that the Christian life is really only one of hardship and difficulty, of duties, of trials and persecution. We talk about those things a lot because they certainly are a part of God's plan, which we know not only by reading the Bible and by reading church history, but also by our own experience. But we do need to remember that's not all that it is. It's also a life of joy, and it is a life of pleasure. I think that we understand that there was no believer who has ever lived that had it easy throughout their entire life. And yet it's equally true that no true believer would ever choose any other kind of life than this life, notwithstanding its difficulties, because it is the path, the only path, that leads to blessing, because it is the path that leads to God. Now, I've already mentioned in our psalm this evening, the writer is expressing essentially the same thing. He's expressing his struggles as one of God's people. Which clearly wasn't uncommon in the lives of those who loved and served and followed the Lord. Most of these psalms are lamentations, vows to the Lord that if he would deliver them from their particular difficulties, they would come and worship him. This psalmist was under a great deal of oppression, and it seemed to him that the Lord had abandoned him. And again, I would ask you, if this hasn't been part of your experience, especially when we're undergoing trials and difficulties, it does seem like the Lord is somehow missing. Seems like he's hidden his face, certainly his face of blessing, but obviously that is not the only way the Lord appears. And yet, even when he was under this pressure, his greatest desire was to be near to the Lord. It didn't take away his love for the Lord. It may have made him wonder whether or not the Lord had abandoned him, but he still desired him, still desired that the Lord would deliver him and would bring him back to Zion, back to the hill where the Lord's house is, to his temple, that he might again go to his altar, that he might spend time with the Lord, the one who was, notwithstanding all the difficulties that he had to face in his service, his exceeding joy, his superlative joy. Now here again is a wonderful example of what we saw, I'm not sure how many weeks ago now, but in Psalm 84, verse 5, an example of one in whose heart are the highways to Zion. His only desire was to be back where the Lord was, to be near to the Lord, because he loved him. His strength was in God, and it was that pleasure that he found in him that drew him to him. Now, this evening, I want us to consider that God not only made us to glorify him, he also made us to enjoy him. And really, the only path in which we may enjoy him is the path he calls us to walk on, by which we might glorify him. Glorifying God by worshiping him as we live as he calls us to live, and especially, and again, I would ask you to just examine your own life, look back on it, and see if this hasn't been your experience, especially when we seek to lead others to worship him through evangelism. This should not be a burden to us, but it should actually bring us the greatest joy. And certainly it will if we're doing it for the right reasons, if our heart is right with God, because when we do this, it brings us closer to the one who is to us what he was to the psalmist, our exceeding joy. When we give glory to the Lord, it certainly honors him, but because we love him, it also gives us joy and pleasure, not to mention the fact that in doing these things, we are nearer to him. Now, let me just begin by saying that when we examine the life of our Lord Jesus, this is certainly what we find, that he experienced this joy and this pleasure in his Father. His greatest joy came from giving glory to his Father, particularly in the most important work which our Lord came to do, and that was to proclaim the kingdom, to do the work of evangelism. Remember, he came to the lost sheep of the house of Israel, and when he did that work, it brought him his greatest joy. When Jesus saw how his Father was working through the evangelism that he was doing and that his disciples were doing, and particularly how the Lord was bringing this about, how he was hiding his glory, the truth of the gospel, from not the truth of it so much, but what people were actually seeing from those who thought themselves to be wise, and that would be the scribes and the Pharisees, the ones who thought they already knew the Lord, but that the Father was revealing it to those whom the intelligentsia, or these righteous elite, thought to be ignorant and immature. He rejoiced in him. We read in Luke 10, verse 21. At that very time, he rejoiced greatly in the Holy Spirit and said, I praise you, O Father, Lord of heaven and earth, that you have hidden these things from the wise and intelligent and have revealed them to infants. Yes, Father, for this was well-pleasing in your sight. I want you to notice that Luke says that Jesus rejoiced greatly. You know, sometimes, I'm sure you've seen some of those movies that have been made about our Lord Jesus, and you've seen him portrayed in a variety of ways, certain movies where he kind of walks around with this glare on his face and this sort of very stern look, and when he does a miracle, he just sort of raises his hand, and there's almost no emotion. And others where perhaps he may be a little bit too much like, you know, like us. But we do need to understand that Jesus experienced a whole gamut of affections and emotions. And one of the things he experienced perhaps more than any other was this rejoicing, this joy in the Holy Spirit when he did his Father's will. This expression, rejoice greatly, is a word that means that he felt and expressed supreme joy. That is what Jesus experienced in what he saw his Father doing through his work, through the work of his disciples. And he took profound pleasure in worshiping his Father for what he was doing. Jesus found joy and pleasure in glorifying his Father in the work of evangelism. John gives us another, perhaps more striking example or illustration of just how much pleasure Jesus found in this work the Father gave him to do in John chapter 4. Remember when he had finished speaking to the woman at the well of Samaria, and she realized who this one was, the Messiah. She left him and went into the city to tell the men there so they could come out and hear him as well. When she had left, the disciples came back because they had gone into the city to find some food. And when they came back with the food, they urged him to eat. But Jesus said to them in John 4, verses 32 through 34, "I have food to eat that you do not know about." So the disciples were saying to one another, "No one brought him anything to eat, did he?" Jesus said to them, "My food is to do the will of him who sent me and to accomplish his work." That was our Lord's desire. Now, eating is perhaps one of the things that brings us one of the greatest pleasures in life, especially when we're hungry, and particularly when the food is especially good. I mean, just about anything tastes good when you're really hungry. Jesus was hungry. That's the reason why he was waiting, why his disciples went into the city. But Jesus actually found more pleasure and more satisfaction in bringing the gospel to this woman and to those that she was going to bring from the city to him than he found in the food, because this is what brought the greatest honor to his Father. Jesus enjoyed what he was doing. He took pleasure in it because he was honoring the one he loved the most. And then we see this lastly expressed in two parables that Jesus told the scribes and the Pharisees in Luke 15, verses 1 through 10. And it again expresses the heart of our Savior. Listen to what Luke writes. He says, "Now all the tax collectors and the sinners were coming near him to listen to him. Both the Pharisees and the scribes began to grumble, saying, 'This man receives sinners and eats with them.' So he told them this parable, saying, 'What man among you, if he has 100 sheep and has lost one of them, does not leave the 99 in the open pasture and go after the one which is lost until he finds it? When he has found it, he lays it on his shoulders, rejoicing. And when he comes home, he calls together his friends and neighbors, saying to them, "Rejoice with me, for I have found my sheep which was lost." I tell you that in the same way, there will be more joy in heaven over one sinner who repents than over 99 righteous persons who need no repentance. Or what woman, if she has 10 silver coins and loses one coin, does not light a lamp and sweep the house and search carefully until she finds it? When she has found it, she calls together her friends and neighbors, saying, "Rejoice with me, for I have found the coin which I had lost." In the same way, I tell you, there is joy in the presence of the angels of God over one sinner who repents. Now, when Jesus said these things, we do need to remember that he was expressing the joy in his own heart over the salvation of one which was lost but is found. Jesus is the shepherd in this parable who rejoices in finding his lost sheep. He's represented by the woman who rejoices over this precious coin that she's lost, but she has found. When the lost are saved, the Father is glorified. Heaven rejoices, and so does our Lord Jesus. There is joy in glorifying God. There is joy in doing the work of the kingdom. There is pleasure. And really, that's what we ought to find, is pleasure and not fear and not reluctance. This is really the same kind of joy that we can experience when we set our hearts to give him glory. Now, I've already mentioned before, nothing brings us greater joy than having what it is we want the most, what it is we love the most. And what we love the most is God, as Jesus loved his Father. And if we can draw near to him in worshiping him, particularly by glorifying him as Jesus did, in giving him glory and praise, in living as he calls us to live, in sharing his message with others, we can also have a share, or we can participate in the joy and the pleasure which our Lord experienced. we do need to understand that this is really what the Lord intends, which is why he calls us to do what he calls us to do, because this is where that joy is actually found. As a matter of fact, we didn't read any examples of this in our Lord Jesus' case, although there certainly are those to be found, but we can experience this joy even when in doing what the Lord has called us to do, we end up suffering for what we do. And I wanted to draw upon the Apostle Paul perhaps as our primary example. Remember, if we had some time, perhaps we could read those passages in 2 Corinthians where Paul lists out all the things that he had to endure for the sake of our Lord Jesus. But let's look at this summary in Colossians 1, verse 24. Paul writes, "Now I rejoice in my sufferings for your sake, and in my flesh I do my share on behalf of his body, which is the church, in filling up what is lacking in Christ's afflictions." I want you to notice, first of all, Paul says here he rejoices in these sufferings. As a matter of fact, he rejoiced in the fact that he was able to take abuse that was meant for his Lord. Because we realize Paul does not mean here that Jesus, when he went to the cross, did not suffer enough in his work to reconcile us to God. He suffered enough. There wasn't anything more that needed to be done to redeem us, but what he means is that the world was not able to vent all of its hatred against Jesus simply by killing him. And so it continued to persecute, and to this day continues to persecute. Again, just look at the news. Those who follow Jesus. Paul rejoiced. The word means he was delighted that he was able to take some of that abuse that was meant for his Lord upon himself. And when you again look at that catalog of what he suffered in 2 Corinthians, it's remarkable that he could rejoice or delight in all that suffering. Now think about your own experience, as I need to think about mine. Have you found that joy? I mean, haven't you found that your greatest joy actually comes in these paths that we're talking about? By spending time with the Lord where he reveals himself, when you spend time with him, wherever it be, in public or private worship, in the Word of God, seeking him in prayer, in praising him, in fellowshipping with his people. Haven't you found this joy in humbling yourself, even as Jesus did, to serve your brothers and sisters in the Lord, when the Lord uses you actually to encourage somebody, to help somebody? I don't think there's anything that brings greater pleasure than that, and particularly when you share the gospel with someone who needs the Lord Jesus. There is just something about it. God gives a greater joy, because in that moment where you're actually inviting people to come to Jesus or telling them about what Jesus Christ has done, God is drawing nearer to you at that moment than he may be in other circumstances, and also nearer to that person that you are speaking with. And I think there's even an added amount of joy and pleasure when, in doing this, you actually suffer for what you have done in his name. Again, God does not call us to do these things for nothing. Certainly, he has promised rewards in heaven. Jesus told us in the Sermon on the Mount that we need to store up our treasures in heaven and not upon the earth. We do that when we glorify God, when we serve him. But those treasures are not reserved just for heaven. God also blesses us on earth. He draws near to us, and he gives us joy. Maybe the reason why we're not experiencing as much joy as we might otherwise do is because we're not looking for it in the right places. If we want to experience more of this pleasure, we need to seek to give God more glory. As we sang this morning in that hymn, "Fill Thou My Life, O Lord My God, and Every Part with Praise," we need to seek his glory with the whole of our lives. We're only going to find the Lord, remember, on the path where he is actually walking, in the places where he is. And the Lord only walks in the paths of righteousness. David writes in Psalm 16, verse 11, "You will make known to me the path of life. In your presence is fullness of joy. In your right hand there are pleasures forever." These things are true, and this is the only place where we're actually going to find the greatest pleasure that God has given us to enjoy. Fellowship with God is the only way to gain this exceeding joy, this superlative and lasting pleasure. We're not going to find it anywhere else. We're certainly not going to find it in what God has made, in what is created. I mean, everything besides God is a creature. Everything else is created. And by definition, everything else is finite. Everything else is limited, which means it can only give us a limited amount of pleasure. It soon runs out. That's why I've used this example many times, because I've experienced it, you've experienced it. This thing that you want so badly that you can't live without, you get it, and within a few weeks, it becomes meaningless to you because it can only give you so much pleasure. And after it's done, it's over, okay? But that's not the case with God. With God, because he is not limited, God is infinite. And there's no limit, then, to the pleasure that he can give. God is also eternal, unlike the creation or the creatures. There's no end to the pleasure that God can give. We need to find our pleasure and our joy in the Lord, because he alone can satisfy. Now, one last thing to consider is this, and that is that when we glorify God and we experience his joy, that we're not the only ones who are blessed. God is also, in a sense, blessed. Now, we have to be careful how we understand that, especially in our understanding of God, but let's consider a couple of passages that talks about how God takes pleasure, how he delights in the things that we do when we do what is glorifying to him. Psalmist writes in Psalm 149, verse 4, "For the Lord takes pleasure in his people. He will beautify the afflicted ones with salvation." I think the implication here is that when we suffer for the Lord, when we are afflicted, God particularly will beautify us. Solomon writes in Proverbs 11, verse 20, "The perverse in heart are an abomination to the Lord, but the blameless in their walk are his delight." God takes pleasure in us. God delights in us when we do what it is he calls us to do. Now, it is true that something we need to understand about God is that God, because he is infinite, has everything that he has to an infinite degree. God is blessed. He's perfectly blessed and really can't be blessed any more than he is. He is essentially a full bucket. We can't add really anything to his happiness. He couldn't be any happier than he is. When he tells us to glorify him, it's not because he needs to have additional pleasure and joy. It's not because he isn't happy enough. He tells us to glorify him because it's the right thing to do. He's certainly worthy of our glory, but also because it's what we need. It's good for us. God doesn't need our praise, but we need to praise him because he delights to bless those who do. But I can't help but adding this, and this is something, again, that John Gerstner, as he was studying Jonathan Edwards, brought out, and I think it's something we need to think about. God in his divinity is a full bucket. We can't add to his happiness. But it's true, it's also true that Jesus is God and man. And as man, he actually can be happier by the things we do. We can actually add to his bucket when we take pleasure in him. He loves it when we spend time with him. He loves it when we glorify him and his Father and we walk with them. He loves it when we share his gospel as he calls us to do. And so in a certain sense, we do add to the happiness, the joy, and the pleasure of our Lord Jesus in his humanity. And in a certain sense, because the person of that man is God, there's a sense in which we add to the blessedness of God. So we're not the only ones who are gaining pleasure by giving glory to Him. We are also giving Him pleasure. And let's not forget, God delights in what He sees us doing when we're doing what is pleasing to Him. So let's not forget that as we seek to glorify Him, we are giving pleasure to God, and we are becoming more blessed. Certainly, if you love the Lord, that's what you want to do. You want to please Him. You want to honor Him. And if you love the Lord, you also want to find your joy in Him. That joy is only going to be found, that pleasure is only going to be found by walking with Him. Well, let's take a few moments and let's bow in prayer, and let's ask the Lord to help us to realize this is true and to purpose then to seek our pleasure in Him.